Hey guys, it's your favorite medical channel, Medicosis Perfectionalis, where medicine makes perfect sense. We continue our playlist called Pulmonology or Pulmonary Medicine or Respiratory Medicine. And in the previous video, we started talking about the pulmonary function test. Today, we continue on talking about FEV1 to FVC ratio, how we use it to differentiate between normal obstructive lung disease and restrictive lung disease. The patients inhale from the spirometer, and then we ask him to actually inhale maximally and then exhale maximally and quickly. This is the FVC. We measure what percentage of the volume came in the first second, and we get this ratio, and it helps us big time clinically. With that being said, now let's get started. In the previous video, I've told you the difference between vital capacity and forced vital capacity. Forced vital capacity, which is today's topic, is timed. It has a lower value if compared to vital capacity because it's timed. We ask the patient to actually inhale rapidly and exhale rapidly, so it takes less time. That's why it has a lower value. In vital capacity, it's not timed. The patient has its time to inhale. So it has a higher value because there is more volume involved. Don't confuse FVC with FRC. Okay, Mr. John, please. Inhale and exhale maximally and quickly. This is called FVC. We measure out of this FVC how much volume came out during the first second. And this is called FEV1, 1 for 1 second. FVC stands for forced vital capacity. This stands for forced expiratory volume on the first second, in the first second. Okay. Normally, it should have a 4 to 5 ratio, which happens to be equals 80%. So normally, FEV1 to FVC ratio equals 80%. Let's talk about obstructive lung disease. What is the definition? I cannot get the air out. Example, emphysema. If I cannot get the air out, I will have a barrel chest because I have increased residual volume and therefore increased total lung capacity. FEV1 is reduced. No kidding. Because there is reduction of my ability to get the air out. That's why they have wheezing. FVC is also reduced. Absolutely, same concept. But FEV1 to FVC ratio is reduced because that reduction in FEV1 is greater than the reduction in FVC. So here is FEV1 over FVC. If you reduced this more than the denominator, the result is decrease in the FEV1 to FVC ratio. And this is an obstructive lung disease. Why? Because the effect is greater in the first second. It's like this. I cannot get the air out. So instead of the FEV1 being 80% of the FVC, now it's about 60% or 50% or 30% because I couldn't get air during the first second. So if the normal ratio FEV1 to FVC was 4 liters over 5 liters equals 80%. In cases of obstructive lung disease, it's about 2.4 liters over 4 liters, which happens to be 60%, or less, could be less. So to diagnose an obstructive lung disease, you need two steps. Number one, you calculate the FEV1 to FVC ratio, and it's going to be less than 70%. That's the definition of an obstructive lung disease. Why? I cannot get the air out, especially in the first second. Then, to determine the severity of the obstructive lung disease, you might have a patient with mild emphysema. You might have a patient with severe emphysema. What is the difference? Now you look at the FEV1 alone. Not the FEV1 FVC ratio, but the FEV1 alone to determine the severity. The lower the ratio, the greater the severity, the more severe the case. So if a patient A has FEV1 of 2.4 liters and patient B has FEV1 of 1.9 liters, which one has a more severe obstructive lung disease? And the answer is patient B. That was obstructive lung disease. Now let's talk about restrictive lung disease. What is the definition? restrictive lung disease. My lungs are restricted from filling. I cannot get the air in, not out. Example, lung fibrosis. If I cannot get the air in, therefore, there is less air coming out. Because I had less air coming in to begin with. So what's happening to FEV1? Decrease. How about FVC? Also decrease. The lung is not normal. But if you have FEV1 here and FVC here, the reduction in FVC was greater than the reduction in FEV1, leading to an increased FEV1 to FVC ratio, or it could be normal at best. So instead of getting 5 liters out, called FVC, I only got 4 liters. But during the first second, I got 3.5 liters out, which happens to be 88%. The ratio is higher than normal. Why? Because your lung is fibrosed. Translation, it has a lower compliance but an increased elastic recoil. Okay, it's very hard to get the air in, but it's easy to get the air out. Why? I have very, very strong fibers. That's why the FEV1 has a greater ratio as a percentage of the FVC. So, to diagnose a restrictive lung disease such as lung fibrosis, step number one, check the FEV1-FVC ratio. It's going to be normal or increased. Then, check all of the volumes, FEV1, FVC, TLC, RV, FRC, SVC, they are all decreased. I'm sorry, this is FVC. Okay, they are all decreased. Why? Because my lung is restricted from filling. I have less air coming into my lung, and therefore I will have less air coming out of my lungs. It's called common sense. Now here is a very good question. Let's say that you have an FEV1 to FVC ratio, and it was normal. We have two probabilities. Number one, it's a normal person, or it's a patient with a restrictive lung disease. Both of them can have a normal ratio. How to tell which is which? First, you look at the FEV1 and FVC alone without the ratio. So the FEV1 is going to be lower, that's a restrictive lung disease. FVC is also going to be lower, that's a restrictive lung disease. But if the subject is normal, FEV1 is normal, FVC is normal, FEV1 to FVC ratio is normal. But if the patient had a restrictive lung disease, such as a pulmonary fibrosis, he will have decreased FEV1, decreased FVC, normal FEV1 to FVC ratio. Or, of course, it could be increased. And also check all of the lung volumes. How to determine the severity of a restrictive lung disease? Check the TLC. The lower the TLC, the greater the severity. Now, students hate these graphs, but they are actually very easy. This is not calculus. This is not astrophysics. This is like fifth grade stuff. So here is FEV1, here is FVC. Here is 4 liters, 5 liters. Can you get the ratio? Yes. 4 divided by 5 is 80%. Excellent. Let's do it with obstructive lung disease. FEV1 is 2.4 liters. FVC is 4. 2.4 over 4 is about 60%, which happens to be decreased. Less than 80%. Restrictive lung disease, 3.5 over 4. 3.5 over 4 is 88%. Can you comment? Yes. In normal people, FEV1 FVC ratio is normal. In obstructive lung disease, it's decreased. In restrictive lung disease, it's increased. Or it could be normal. If you really don't want to think, here is a very great mnemonic. Obstructive lung disease obscures the ratio, decreases. Restrictive lung disease raises the ratio, or at least remains constant. Let's dig deeper into obstructive lung disease, such as emphysema, which is a COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. The patient cannot get the air out, leading to air trapping. That's why the patient has a barrel chest. This has decreased elastic recoil because you have destroyed all of the elastin fibers, but you will have increased compliance. And the analogy that I use is your very old socks with a lax rubber band like this. It's very easy to expand the socks because there is no resistance. The rubber band is destroyed. It's done. But if you leave the sock alone, it's not gonna recoil. So you have decreased recoil tendency, but increased compliance. It's similar to distensibility or expansibility. residual volume in obstructive lung disease is increased. You are trapping the air in, you have a barrel chest. Functional residual capacity, or FRC, is increased because FRC equals expiratory reserve volume plus this residual volume. If the residual volume is high, the FRC is going to be high. It's called common sense. Total lung capacity is high. Why? Because the residual volume is increased. You are trapping the air in because you cannot get the air out. That's the definition of an obstructive lung disease. Forced vital capacity is decreased. FEV1 is decreased. FEV1 to FVC ratio is decreased. It's less than 80% of predicted. Let's talk about restrictive lung disease, such as pulmonary fibrosis. You cannot get the air in. My lungs are restricted from filling. Therefore, I have decreased compliance. You can still get the air out. It's normal recoil. I try to think about it theoretically, just for me, as increased recoil. So it's easier to empty your lung of air if your lung didn't have as much air to begin with. Okay, all right. Also, if it's a fibrosis, you have more fibers in your lungs, and this is gonna increase the recoil. Again, this is theoretical. PFTs, residual volume decrease. All of the volume and capacities are decreased in restrictive lung disease. You cannot get the air in. There is less air coming in. Therefore, there is less air coming out. Therefore, all of the volumes and capacities are decreased. How about FRC? Also decreased. How about TLC? Decreased. In restrictive lung disease, all volumes are reduced because the lung is restricted from filling. FVC decreased. FEV1 decreased. FEV1 to FVC ratio normal to increased. But here is where spirometry fails to actually diagnose the disease. We have two types of restrictive lung disease. It could be intrinsic or extrinsic. Intrinsic means the problem is in the lung itself. Extrinsic means it's outside of the lung. Example, thoracic cavity, the thoracic cage. It can also be muscle weakness, chest wall deformity, or nerve damage. How to differentiate between intrinsic and extrinsic restrictive lung disease? After all, if you do FEV1 to FVC ratio, both can have normal or increased ratio. So the spirometry didn't help you distinguish between those two diseases, did it? So how do we solve this? You need something else. You need something called flow volume loop, which we'll talk about later, DLCO, which we'll talk about later, and AA gradient, which we'll talk about later. That's why you should subscribe and save my great playlist. It's called Pulmonology Guys. Please do it because it's just good for you. Here's a very common mistake that students make. Sir, your FEV1 to FVC ratio is normal. Therefore, you're normal and there is nothing to worry about. Shut up. Normal FEV1 FVC ratio could be a normal person or a patient with restrictive lung disease, whether intrinsic or extrinsic. So, if you have a patient with normal ratio, it can be normal or it can be restrictive. How can you tell the difference? First, you look at all of the lung volumes and capacities. If it's a restrictive lung disease, all of them are going to be decreased. That's restrictive. If they are normal, the patient is normal. If they are low, oh no! And second thing, you can do a flow volume loops. And by the way, there is a difference between flow volume loops and pressure volume loops. And we'll talk about pressure volume loops in the next video and about flow volume loops in a later video. Here is another tricky question. Let's say that we have a patient with low FEV1 to FVC ratio. The ratio is less than 70%. Therefore, it's an obstructive lung disease. Okay, we got it. And then we look at the FEV1 alone to determine the severity of the obstruction. If it's 50 to 80% of predicted, because remember, normally is 80, this is moderately reduced. 35 to 49 of predicted, this is severely reduced. Less than 4%, it's very severely reduced. Now, there's a question. Okay, now you have diagnosed an obstructive lung disease based on the low FEV1 to FVC ratio. But is it asthma or is it COPD? And by the way, COPD includes two diseases, chronic bronchitis as well as emphysema. Okay, it could be asthma, it could be COPD. All of these guys are obstructive lung disease. How can you tell the difference? And the answer is give bronchodilator. If after giving bronchodilator, such as a beta 2 agonist, you find significant improvement and increase in FEV1, this is irreversible obstruction, which happens in asthma. But if there is no significant increase in FEV1, the patient did not improve after the introduction of the beta 2 agonist, this is a fixed obstruction, such as COPD, thanks to the horrible habit of cigarette smoking. I'm not talking about cigars, I'm talking about cigarettes. Okay, both of them are bad, but when we're talking about COPD, we're talking about cigarette smoking. Now let's summarize. In brief, not boxers. Low FEV1 to FVC ratio, that's an obstructive lung disease. Low TLC, that's probably a restrictive lung disease, restricted from filling. High FEV1 to FVC ratio, this is a restrictive lung disease. Low FEV1 to FVC ratio and low TLC, that's a mixed disorder. You have an obstructive lung disease, that's why your FEV1 to FVC ratio is low, and you have a restrictive lung disease, that's why your TLC is low. Also, don't forget that if the FEV1 to FVC ratio is normal, we have two probabilities. A, the patient is normal. B, the patient has restrictive lung disease, which could be intrinsic or it could be extrinsic. Spirometer cannot tell the difference between intrinsic and extrinsic restrictive lung disease. How do we do it? You have one of three choices. A, flow volume loop. B, DLCO. Or C, AA gradient. Spirometry limitations and solutions. Now tell me who on the planet organized the information like this. Kaplan Medical? Oh, give me a break. I'm joking. Okay, limitations of the freaking spirometry. Number one, it cannot measure the residual volume, and therefore it cannot measure two capacities, FRC and TLC. Okay, what is the solution? Go to a PFT laboratory. By the way, spirometry is done at the bedside. Any doctor, any nurse, any physician assistant on the freaking planet can do it. But if you're talking about PFT lab, that's a specialized lab for pulmonary function tests. Like advanced stuff, those are specialists. They earn more money. Okay, just make it, just be honest. Then, to determine the residual volume, you can use one of these four techniques. A, helium dilution method. B, radiographic planimetry. C, body plethysmography. My goodness, nitrogen washout. Okay, we get it. Second limitation. Okay, this spirometry, misleading. What do you mean? I mean, the patient comes complaining of cough, shorts of breath, which is dyspnea, which is SOB, which stands for shorts of breath because I don't curse. Okay, the patient is like in a horrible condition and the spirometry results are normal. How come? Because if it's asthma, it's probably gonna be normal because asthma patients have asthma during asthma attacks. If you did the freaking test, not in an asthma attack, the patient's gonna be normal. So, how do we solve this problem? You do a methacholine challenge test, again, in a specialized lab. You don't do it by the bedside because the patient can die. You don't do it on your in your stupid office because the patient can die. This is a serious test. The patient can obstruct all of his airways and collapse on the floor. You need to have a ventilator close by. Okay, you give methacholine. Methacholine is a muscarinic agonist. Therefore, it constricts your bronchi. When it constricts your bronchi, you are provoking an asthma episode. If the patient starts wheezing and becomes a positive test, you have your diagnosis. Third limitation, the freaking spirometry cannot differentiate between asthma, which is reversible obstruction, and COPD, which is a fixed obstruction. What is the solution? You give a short-acting beta agonist, SABA, short-acting beta, such as the famous albuterol, and then you measure the PFTs. This is also known as beta-2 agonist challenge. So we have two challenges here. Here was the methacholine challenge. Why? To diagnose asthma. And here is a beta-2 agonist challenge. Why? To differentiate between asthma and COPD. Asthma will improve. What do you mean? The FEV1 will increase. COPD, no change. The FEV1 will stay the same. I don't mean like the same, like a very minimal change, but with asthma, it's going to be a significant change. Fourth limitation of the stupid spirometry. It cannot differentiate between intrinsic and extrinsic restrictive lung disease. Intrinsic such as pulmonary fibrosis, extrinsic such as kyphoscoliosis. So how do we solve it? You'll need a flow volume loop, or a DLCO, or an AA gradient. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe and join the tribe. Hit the bell to get notifications when I release new videos, such as the awesome videos coming next, which are pressure volume loops, DLCO, flow volume loops, ventilation, perfusion, and the VQ mismatch, and even the alveolar gas equation. Please consider supporting this channel even with $1 to help me produce more videos in the future, and I will send you my notes, my cases, my audio notes. All of them are organized in Dropbox folders, and you will just download them and keep them for you forever. And you can go to my Facebook page. I have 100 cases there. Thank you so much for watching. This is Medicosis Perfectionales, where medicine makes perfect sense. Until next time, please be safe, stay happy, and study hard.